We also have breaking news tonight in Sudan. A U.S. military official telling CNN that a team of Marines is now en route to the capital, Khartoum. The team is known as Fleet Anti-Terrorism Security Team, and they are going to defend the embassy. As you can see, and we're showing you the scene in Khartoum today, spread beyond the U.S. embassy, mobs attacked both the British and German embassies as well. And Sudan was one of many countries as violence spread around the Muslim world today. The anti-American uprisings have spread now to more than a dozen countries, from Morocco all the way to India. We want to show you a map because we saw protests. This is incredible to see. Tunisia, Yemen, Iraq, Iran, Israel, just some of them. And protests also spread to a country not even on that map, the world's largest Muslim populated country, Indonesia. Now, some of the protests were peaceful, like in Jordan, where they burned the American flag but did not resort to violence. But people were killed in violent protests elsewhere as protesters stormed American embassies and consulates. This is the live scene in Cairo tonight, where there have been dozens of arrests and injuries. Security forces have faced off with crowds. They've tried to disperse them with tear gas and get them to go away from the U.S. embassy. As you can see right here, this is a group of people who are near the U.S. embassy. They are still there tonight as they continue to be there day in and day out as the rage continues to spread. In Libya, the remains of four Americans killed during the attack on the U.S. consulate in Benghazi returned to the Andrews Air Force Base this afternoon. President Obama was there, and he vowed to bring justice to the men who killed them.
That even as voices of suspicion and mistrust seek to divide countries and cultures from one another, the United States of America will never retreat from the world.
Four people have been arrested in Libya who were on the scene of the attack, but the government says that they are not actually linked to the murders. That investigation continues, and we have a live report on that right now. Arwa Damon is with me from Benghazi tonight. And Arwa, I know you had a chance to go to the consulate there. What did you see?
Aaron, it was really quite chilling, horrifying to be walking through some of the buildings there, just imagining what had transpired, taken place. They were all burnt. There was black soot covering the walls, the ceiling, ashes over some of the furniture, the chandeliers. There was debris all over the floor. Looters also had moved in after the attack took place, pillaging this compound that even after the assault was really not secured, though one would have anticipated it to be so, given how much sensitive evidence was in fact on site. In the kitchen, for example, there were bits of made ready eat meals that the U.S. military does tend to use. There were also various other cakes sort of strewn about, pieces of paper, one of them reading across it, "Libya is so important." While we were there, we also saw Libya's president, who was saying that at this point in time, they do believe that this attack was carried out by a group or groups of extremists. They're not identifying them as of yet, but they were also saying that they believe that this was a pre-planned attack that was intended to inflict maximum damage, to drive an irreparable wedge between the U.S. and the Libyans. What is disturbing, though, is that the Libyan government at this point is actually saying that they cannot prevent such attacks from repeating themselves, and that they do not have the capability right now to rein in these various and numerous armed extremist elements.
Which is a frightening and damning statement. But Arwa, let me ask you, we've been looking at some of the pictures that you saw, the scene when you walked into the consulate with the pieces of paper and the debris and the ash all over the top of some of the furniture that you took pictures of. I know you also had a chance while you were there to speak with one of the Libyan security guards who was at the consulate during the attack. What did he tell you?
One needs to know, too, that the first line of defense for the embassy, according to the security guard and others who were on site as well, are unarmed Libyans. They have radios. That's how they man the main gates into this compound. There's also a very small unit of Libyans from the February 17th Brigade, but really just a handful of them in one position on the outskirts of it. So it's not a heavily guarded location as one would anticipate such locations to be, or as they rather are in other countries. This guard was saying that they first heard chanting that grew increasingly louder, and then all of a sudden an intense barrage of heavy machine gun fire, grenades, rocket-propelled grenades One of the rocket-propelled grenades, we are being told, took the power out. Remember, this happening at night. So with that power gone, complete darkness, buildings set on fire. You can just imagine how chaotic and terrifying the scenes would have been. This one guard says that at one point, after these masked men, bearded men, stormed the compound, they threw him to the ground and at gunpoint threatened to kill him for being an infidel. Other details that we're learning too, Aaron, is that this was not the only attack that took place. The February 17th Brigade was the only unit, we are being told, from the Libyan forces that in fact responded and tried to help those in the compound out. They managed to evacuate the U.S. Embassy personnel into what was supposed to be a safe house, but then later on in the early hours of the morning, that safe house was attacked as well. So a lot of questions for the Libyan government, but also a lot of questions being posed to the U.S. side of all of this. Did America, at the end of the day, underestimate the threat level that exists here?
All right. Well, Arwa Damon, thank you very much. A crucial question about how America didn't know this was happening, how this could have happened. We're going to be joined in a few moments by Senator Robert Menendez on the Foreign Relations Committee to put those questions to him, a man who is a key part of the reason why America was involved in Libya to begin with. Now I want to show you the live picture in Cairo again tonight, where, as we told you, dozens have been arrested and the police have been facing off security forces against crowds who have been near the U.S. Embassy, rioting throughout the day. Let's get to Ben Wiedemann, who is in Cairo, has a bird's eye view of exactly what's happening. What are you seeing tonight, Ben?
Well, Aaron, it is 1:15 in the morning, but that doesn't seem to have stopped the young protesters who are down in the street right below me, who are, have been clashing all day long, and in fact, all last night as well, with the Egyptian security forces, who have put up a concrete barrier just about 50 yards from the main wall of the American embassy to stop those protesters from getting any closer. Now, the situation, Aaron, could have been much worse today, but the Muslim Brotherhood, which had announced it would be holding demonstrations across Egypt at mosques away from this particular part of town to condemn that anti-Islamic YouTube video, at the last moment, they canceled those protests. So the number of people who are actually out in the streets protesting either around the embassy or in Tahrir Square or in Alexandria in the north of the country was much smaller than was expected. It's hard to say at this point when these demonstrations around the embassy are going to end. But as I said, it could have been much worse today.
And Ben, while you were talking, I know we just heard the shots and we just saw the car. Everyone, this is a live picture. So you just saw that police car drive up and a security official at the top. Ben, looks like he had a gun and was sort of threatening to shoot people. And then the crowds who were just a moment ago, everyone filling the front of this picture. Now you can see some of the young men coming back in, all ran away. And there were a lot of shots. Tell us about what the clashes have been like, Ben. What are they shooting at them?
What they're shooting, these are tear gas canisters, which are fired from a rifle. By and large, actually, compared to previous outbreaks of violence here in Cairo, this one has been relatively peaceful. That may sound a little silly given the sort of the images you see now, but in previous incidents, dozens of people were killed in these clashes. So this time, the police are using only tear gas, very limited amounts of rubber bullets, and as of yet, no live ammunition. So even though as many as 300 people have been wounded, largely from inhalation of tear gas, a fairly rough tear gas, as I've experienced many times today, no one has actually been killed.
All right, Ben Wiedemann, thank you very much. And an important point there, although there were people who were killed in other countries, including Tunisia and Sudan.